Plant lice of the family Aphididae, one of the largest families in the insect kingdom, are found on all kinds of plants throughout the world. This film is about five of the commonest and most destructive of the species which attack apple trees. The permanent or green apple aphis, the rosy apple aphis, the woolly aphis, the oat apple aphis, and the red leaf aphis. Wherever apples are grown, one or more of these five species are to be found, and the damage they do is considerable. This is the rosy aphis, which besides attacking the apple, is also found as a parasite on other plants. This is the red leaf aphis. It too is commonly found on many different host plants. Bright red blisters on the leaves are an unmistakable sign of its activities. And here is the distinctive sign of another species, the trademark of the woolly aphis. These insects cover themselves with waxy threads, which look like tufts of cotton wool, sticking to the foliage, fruit, and branches of infested trees. If the wool is dissolved away with alcohol, the purplish-brown aphids are revealed. In addition to the damage due to loss of sap, the punctures made by these insects cause abnormal growths of the young wood, which swell and split, allowing the entry of the canker fungus. The oat apple aphis is less injurious, though it will damage the young shoots and blossom trusses. The alternative hosts are cereal crops and grasses. The life histories of these different species show many minor variations. For the purpose of this film, we shall follow, where possible, the life cycle of the green apple aphis, Aphis pomae. The female lays her eggs in the autumn on the bark of the apple trees. The eggs are oval in shape and about 1 millimeter long. When freshly laid, the eggs are pale yellowish green. In a short time, they darken, and within a few days, they turn black and shiny. Here, the color change, seen by time-lapse photography, took about a week. The eggs lie dormant throughout the winter. Where trees are heavily infested with Aphis pomae, the overwintering eggs can be found in masses on the twigs and branches. Not all species lay their eggs in masses. The rosy aphis, for instance, lays its eggs singly. The eggs remain unaltered on the trees until the time in spring when many of the commercial varieties of apple are at the bud burst stage. When the appropriate time arrives, the eggs hatch. The tough eggshell ruptures and the nymph emerges. But the creature is still swathed in an embryonic membrane which covers the whole body. Here the movements of the nymph can be seen as it struggles to burst the membrane. Here the limbs are visible through the membrane. Eventually the limbs break through and the young nymph emerges. There follows a pause during which the limbs, antennae and general body covering harden in the air. Most of the eggs hatch at about the same time, and the dark green nymphs leave the bark of the trees and congregate on the buds where they start to feed on the young growth. All the damage caused by aphids is due to their feeding and its secondary effects. The method of feeding is to pierce the plant tissues and suck the sap. The mouthparts are specially adapted for this purpose. The mandibles and maxillae are modified into slender grooved stylets enclosed in a sheath or rostrum. In this preparation, the stylets are shown partially withdrawn from the rostrum. Together, these stylets form a double tube. When the insect feeds, the tip of the rostrum is placed on the surface of the plant and the stylets are thrust into the tissues. Saliva is ejected down one side of the double tube and the sap is sucked up the other. The feeding nymphs spread rapidly over the new growth of the apple trees. Damage to the young shoots and sometimes to the flower stalks is characteristic of infestation by Aphis pomae. Later in the season, they move onto the lower surfaces of the leaves. At this time, the most obvious indication of their presence on the tree is the curling of the leaves. But there are other signs of their activity. The aphis carries a pair of tubes called cornicles on its abdomen. These produce small droplets of a substance called honeydew. The honeydew falls onto the leaves beneath the feeding aphids, where it provides an excellent medium for the growth of sooty molds, which in turn further upset the functioning of the leaves. Ants use this honeydew for food. Here they are not attacking the aphids, as is often supposed, but milking them to get the honeydew from the cornicles. The damage caused by the feeding of large numbers of aphids is very considerable. Though the creature itself is so small, each individual takes its quota from the sap of the tree, and in a severe infestation, the total drain may be sufficient to do irreparable harm to the growth of the tree. As the nymphs feed, they grow, molting three times before reaching maturity. When about to molt, a ragged tear appears on the abdomen. The shriveled, papery skin is forced forward as the abdomen swells and ecdysis proceeds. A prolonged struggle takes place while the creature strives to withdraw its thorax, head, and limbs from the old skin. When the aphis has freed itself entirely, the cast skin is discarded and ecdysis is complete. The nymphs which hatch from the winter eggs mature as parthenogenetic females, which are capable of reproduction without fertilization by a male. Further, their unfertilized eggs develop within the body, and the young are eventually ejected as fully formed, though small, nymphs. At the moment of birth, the nymph is enclosed in an embryonic membrane, just like the nymphs which hatched from the winter eggs. This membrane soon ruptures and the creature is freed. Each mature female can produce a large number of these viviparous offspring, which will grow up in their turn as parthenogenetic females. Many generations are produced in this way by parthenogenesis. Should all these insects survive, it might well be that all the available plant life would soon be exhausted. Fortunately, there are a number of insects which prey upon the aphids and help to keep down their numbers. Among these, the syrphidae or hoverflies are very useful. Here is one laying its eggs near a colony of aphids. The larvae of the syrphidae eat large quantities of aphids. These are the eggs of the lacewing fly, whose larvae are equally destructive to the aphids. Perhaps the most important of all the predators are the larvae of the coccinellidae or ladybirds. These are found wherever aphids occur, and they devour the pests by the hundred. During the course of the summer, the parthenogenetic aphids produce an increasing proportion of nymphs which grow wings. These nymphs can be recognized by the dark wing pads on the thorax, which grow larger at each successive molt. These winged aphids are themselves parthenogenetic females and are capable of producing viviparous offspring, both of the winged and wingless kind. As they can fly to other trees, the infestation may be spread much further afield. Early in the autumn, winged males are produced, and with them, the much smaller, wingless, egg-laying sexual females. The males may be distinguished from the winged females of the summer broods by their smaller black bodies. These sexual forms mate in the autumn, Immediately after fertilization, the female starts to lay her winter eggs, ready to start the cycle afresh the following spring. The sequent events in the life cycle of Aphis pomae, the permanent apple aphis, is as follows. The winter is spent in the egg stage on the bark of the apple trees. The nymphs which emerge from the eggs in spring develop into wingless parthenogenetic females. These females produce a succession of viviparous young, which also become parthenogenetic females, and in their turn repeat the process throughout the summer season. A certain number of the females of the later generations possess wings, and they spread to other trees where they produce parthenogenetically wingless females of the original type, and winged females like themselves. In the autumn, both the winged and wingless forms produce a generation of sexual forms. These are winged males and wingless females. From the union of these sexual forms, the winter eggs are produced. This polymorphism of the adult insects is found in one form or another among all members of the family Aphididae.